In this video, we're solving a vertical Atwood machine, and in part A, we're going to find the acceleration of it. And then part B is a kinematics question. We're going to find out exactly how long it takes the heavier mass to hit the ground. So finding the acceleration of it and knowing the distance that it has to travel, we can apply our one-dimensional kinematics equations to get part B done. The first thing I want to do here is convert the masses to kilograms. And that just requires shifting the decimal place three times. So our large mass is 0.385 kilograms. And our small one is 0.195 kilograms. Then we'll go ahead and do our force diagramming. So there's the weight of the large mass, and that's going to be mg. And when I plug in 0.385 kilograms, and then g is 9.8 meters per second squared, I get a weight of 3.773 newtons, just keeping a little extra precision. The other force felt by this block is the tension pulling up on it. And I'm going to show that being shorter than the weight factor, because I know this heavier block is the one accelerating downward, so the net force must be downward. That same tension is felt by the smaller block, provided the pulley is light and frictionless. And then the last force vector here is the weight of that smaller block, and I'm trying to show that a little bit shorter than the tension because I know the small block accelerates upward. We do the same calculation of mg for that smaller block, and that weight vector has a magnitude of 1.911 newtons. Next, I need to be clear about the coordinate system I'm using to analyze the motion of each object. And it's important here to make the actual direction of the acceleration the positive direction as you analyze each one. Well, the large one is accelerating downward. So downward is going to be positive for the analysis, and the small one is accelerating upward. So upward is going to be the positive direction for that one. And then we apply Newton's second law to each of these masses. I have the 0.385 kilogram mass. And I write down F net equals MA, again using downward as positive. So I have 3.773 newtons in the positive direction, and then minus a T, because that's pointing up, and that's equal to the mass, which is 0.385 kilograms times the unknown acceleration. We do the same analysis on the small block, and this time T is the force pointing in the positive direction. So I have a T minus 1.911. is equal to 0.195 times A. And the way we set up our coordinate systems, it guarantees that A is a positive number for both of these equations. That's really important. If A stands for a positive number in one case and negative in the other, it's going to mess up the algebra. The next step is to add the two equations, and when I do that, the T's cancel. And on the left-hand side, I have a 3.773 minus 1.911. That comes out to 1.862. On the right side, I have 0.385a plus another 0.195a, and that comes out to 0.58a. And we can simply solve for a by dividing by that coefficient, and we get 3.21 meters per second squared. Next, we get into our kinematics equation. So I want the time it takes for the larger mass to hit the floor, and we know that it has 20 centimeters to go, and we know it was released from rest. And we just have to pick a practical coordinate system here. So what I'm going to do is put the origin for the motion of the large block. I'm going to put the origin at its starting position and call that y equals 0. And I'm going to use downward as positive, and that means the final position is plus 20 centimeters or 0.20 meters. My acceleration is in that downward direction, so that's a positive 3.21 meters per second squared. My initial velocity for that started from rest, so that's 0. So we write down the kinematics equation describing position as a function of time for this object. And our final position is 0.2 meters. Our initial position was taken to be 0. Our initial velocity was 0. Our acceleration is 3.21 meters per second squared. And then I have a t squared term. So this is a quadratic equation, but it's trivial because the linear and constant terms aren't there. So all we have to do is isolate t squared and take the square root. So multiplying by 2 and dividing by 3.21, I get a 0.1246 on the left-hand side. That's equal to t squared. Take the square root of that, and we get 0.353 seconds. And that's it. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.